In the last few years, you've been working for a company called Handle With Care, and you know, as you're saying, Handle With Care is a company that looks after the manufacturing. People, you know, they've made their track in the studio, but there's this big grey area between having a track finished in the studio and then seeing it on the record shelves, and that's where your company comes in. So, I mean, you know, we'll talk a lot about that later on, but before we go anywhere, maybe we should listen to a track just so, you know, people get a nice idea of where you're at musically. So,
yeah, actually, I thought maybe I'd just play the first record that we released on our label, Electro Music Department, which was started in 94, so it's 10 years old.
And this is a track by yourself and Kotai?
Yes. And I didn't listen to it before, so I'm not sure which side it is.
Well, there's not much happening, you know, so... here there's some changes. So, I mean, the thing is that, it was very minimal.
No, I mean,
and actually we got some respect for that because at that time it was not very popular to do this kind of very minimal stuff. But I mean, for us it was just an aesthetical necessity. So,
when you say you know you had a lot of respect and support, was this just in Germany or you know even outside DJs in America?
Pretty much outside, also. I mean. Yeah, I'm still getting a lot of response to our label. And so I play something that is like, this was release number one done in 94, and this is, I want to play the other side because at that time we were achieving pretty much our own style because, I mean, our equipment was very reduced and it was mainly, our synthesizer was Korg. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, we had like a Korg park. And it was, I mean, you will hear.
And how did the both of you work? Was Kotai more the engineer or were you more the engineer?
No,
or?
I mean, it was complete Democrat. I mean, you know, it could be that, I mean, very often I was coming up with an idea, like this track before, it was, I mean, I just had this word silencer in my head, which I liked, because of the meaning, of the sound, so we started playing around with it, and then we decided that Kotai should just say the word silencer.
Yes.
And. Very often I was taking care of the bass. I was the Korg specialist. But I mean, it just, you know, we were just switching, I mean, jamming.
Yes.
And so I don't know, I mean, it could also be that I was in the end arranging stuff and just putting it together, you know. Whatever.
I mean, with this, you know, minimal sound that you guys were doing, what was playing a big part in influencing you at that time? What were you listening to a lot of?
Influencing, I wouldn't say anything really influenced. I mean, it was, we were very respectful towards Daniel Bell, Rob Hood, and Panasonic, mm-hmm. which are friends. And so it could happen that we were getting close to their sound and we would say, ooh, no. Okay, so this was something that could happen because, I mean, there was some, we were close to them, you know. And I'm sure it happened to them too, you know, so, but it, I think you never should follow some other's ideas, you know, so.
You want to play this?
Yeah, I thought, you know, so you have a...
So, I mean, as you say, this is 1996. It's the sixth release on your label, based mm-hmm. out of Berlin. But going right back, Berlin wasn't always your home. Wasn't your original place of birth?
No, I was originally born in Düsseldorf.
Yes. Now, I mean, tell us about Düsseldorf.
I actually was starting to party at late 70s. I was still quite young then. But that was a time when there was the electronic music happening, like Kraftwerk and La Düsseldorf and Neu, and also punk started. And both were quite massive at the same time.
I mean, obviously, Kraftwerk were from Düsseldorf, so was there a great awareness towards electronic music because, you know, these were your local boys, that kind of thing?
Yeah, I mean, they were just part of it, you know? I mean, it was not a big deal with Kraftwerk at that time in Düsseldorf because there was a kind of a movement. I mean, for example, La Düsseldorf, which probably nobody of you knows, but they were as popular as Kraftwerk at that time, you know? And so there was a club called Ratinger Hof, which was, I mean, it was just all white and metal, you know, and neon light on top. So it was really light. I mean, it was really bright inside, even when the party was on. And so this was when they were also having fashion shows, like late 70s, early 80s fashion shows. I mean,
Düsseldorf had, as well as the music side of things, there were a lot of artists there. There were a lot of galleries there. I mean, has Düsseldorf always had a history of, you know, this art background? And so there was a great symbiosis between what was happening musically with people making music and with artists. People were coming together.
Yeah, I mean, definitely this was like where it came from or what made it happen. You know, that there was also some aesthetic all the time, and I mean this place Ratinger Hof originally was done by the girlfriend of Blinky Palermo. I don't know if you know him. I mean, okay, so it was, I mean, like minimal modern artists, really young artists, and there was another place a little bit before where Nam June Paik was having a video, I mean TV wall, you know, and so there was stuff like that. And then, as I said, I mean, it was at the same time punk was happening heavily. I mean, this street where the club was on, you couldn't pass through if you were not looking punkish. Yes. You know, I mean, they would throw beer bottles at you. It was really dangerous, you know. You could not go there with a cap. If you would come there with a cap and step out, you would definitely be hit by a beer bottle, you know. So it was, I mean, and at the same time, the Kraftwerk guys would come there in their suits and would be respected, you know. I mean, so yeah, that was it.
And you were actually studying art yourself in Düsseldorf?
Yeah, I studied art, painting.
Nice. I mean, how about any in terms of musical, you know, the music industry? Were you doing anything in Düsseldorf?
Well, I think for me personally, I mean, like my personal history is just that I had the desire to create, you know, to do something that I felt that there is a need, because if I don't do it, nobody would do it my way, you know. So this is also something that I still feel like when I'm DJing or when I'm producing, it's just some aesthetical approach, you know. But
you were DJing at the stage before, you know, while you were still in Düsseldorf?
Yeah, I was DJing, but I always, I mean, then it was just art student parties, and I mean, I was even playing music from tapes, and it was a wild mixture of all styles.
Now, I mean, 1991 in Germany, everything changed, you know. I mean, obviously, with the collapse of the wall in Berlin, there was all these exciting new opportunities. Tell us about this time.
Actually, I mean, the change was in 89, but so I came to Berlin in winter 1991, just because I wanted to visit a friend. And I was already then planning to leave Düsseldorf because I finished my studies. And so I was so impressed by this historical moment in this city that I decided to stay there. I mean, I immediately stayed there. It was just a visit, but from then on, I didn't leave.
And you never have left the state.
And so what was happening then was that, I mean, it was a culture clash, you know, of course, because there was this people from East Germany that, for me as a German, were, I mean, we were speaking the same language, and we both called ourselves Germans, but we had a complete different background and a different mentality, you know. I mean, it was just, there was, for example, I mean, I was in immediately living in East Berlin because I thought, okay, if I am already here, I want to be like where it happens. And so I was, this was winter, Berlin winter, close to Siberia, lots of snow up to here, really cold. And I was walking outside, I wanted to go to the store next door to get some, like, I don't know, toilet paper. So something, just quickly go there, grab it, and go back. And I went outside, and in front of the store, there was a queue of people waiting in the middle of this cold winter snow up to here. And I thought, okay, maybe they wait until the shop is opening. But the shop was open. And there was a woman at the cashier, two people inside, walking around, buying stuff. And the rest waiting outside.
Just this whole, the previous mentality that they had of queuing for things.
You know, I mean, I didn't understand why. I didn't know why they were queuing there. So I went inside. I mean, I would just start, okay, wait for whatever you want to wait for. I go and grab my stuff. So I went inside, and this woman at the cashier's, she told me, you need a basket to go make your round, you know. So I said, okay, where are the baskets? There's only two. And they are already in use. So this was a system, you know, and everybody was waiting to get their basket, you know. So, and it of course also had, I mean, there was some logic in it, because you only need one person to be in control of the whole scenery, you know, because there's only two baskets. So this was something that I never experienced before, so it was very interesting, you know.
And also at this time, when you say you moved to East Berlin, you know, for a lot of artists moved to Berlin, especially East Berlin at this time, from not just all over Germany, but all over the world, because there was this whole situation where you had all this free space, empty warehouses, and there was a big squatting scene, yes?
Yeah, there was, especially in this center part of Berlin, there was a lot of empty spaces, which was because it was old buildings. And in East Germany, people didn't want to live in these old buildings. You know, it was not a good idea. I mean, there was coal ovens, if there was, and I mean, just everything breaking down. And so a lot of these buildings were empty. I mean, I've seen flats where wallpaper was coming down, you know, and you could see, I mean, it was like into, I don't know, stalagmites, and yes, you know, yes. I mean, it was really like, you could tell that this place was not inhabited since Second World War, you know. So of course there was a lot of empty space, and you could just go there and throw parties. And because everything was so confused, I mean, the police didn't know what laws should we follow now, you know, because the East Berlin policemen all of a sudden were wearing West Berlin uniforms. And they still had to look up at their books, like, what is the law for somebody riding a bicycle on the sidewalk, you know? So, of course, if you were throwing illegal parties, it was very easy, because nobody was getting after you, you know?
So this whole, you know, what became known as, you know, the Berlin techno scene was kind of, you know, this great vibrancy from that was born out of this whole East Berlin, you know, thing where people could just throw parties, wild parties. You could stay open till like 9 and no one would do anything, and, you know, sell liquor and no one would really know.
Yeah, so, I mean, there was just parties, for example, like one cellar, where you had to walk really down, and it was filled with water, and there was some bridges out of wood, and you had to cross it, and then there was this big sound system, and it was full of people, you know. I mean, you were going there like, where am I going to now? And then there was a big party, but this was only lasting for 2 weeks. And then it was the next location, you know.
I mean, at what point for you did you go, right, I think I can do this better, and you start throwing parties yourself?
Yeah, it was just because I was into music and into dancing. So there was a point where I just was not so satisfied with what I heard. And so I, yeah, then decided I could try it myself. And so I met some people, and they were throwing regular parties at a very small venue, and I became their resident. Then I met Daniel Pflum, who is the visual part of our label, and he just had opened a bar where he was planning to sell his t-shirts and DJ tapes. So he came up to me asking for a DJ tape. I gave it to him, and then I came to his place, and I don't know, it just happened, you know. And then we said, okay, we throw a party, and it really worked. And from then on, we were using this as a club. So this was called Electro, and it was, this was from 92 to 94. And at the end, I mean, after some time, it just happened because I already knew a lot of people. I also started to work at Hardworks, at the record store in Berlin.
For people that don't know Hardworks, what's... Well, it's a bit of a legendary record store, yes?
Yeah, it's, I think, the first techno record store. Techno and reggae. They and it's run by one of the Basic Channel guys, yes. Mark Ernestos.
Because normally techno and reggae, you wouldn't normally associate the two internationally in a record store.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, but they definitely are a lot into reggae.
You rhythm know?
I mean,
and sound.
Yeah, they... are going to Detroit and to Jamaica, you know. It's their two levels that they're working on. And so, yeah, because I was working there, and I just met a lot of people, so it happened that I could get almost everybody to play at our club.
What was your music policy back then?
It was mainly to just give an overview of what was actually happening. So we were, Rob Hood, for example, he played there several times. He did a hip-hop set there because he's very much into hip-hop. And DJ Hell, Electric Indigo, Ali Queed was playing live, Jimmy Tano was playing live. And, I mean, everything was happening on a very low budget level. I mean, the people were not getting any fee for that, you know. I mean, there was no entrance, so I mean, we didn't make any money out of this, but it was just, the atmosphere was so good, and people were so into it that everybody wanted to play there, you know. I mean, and they were friends.
And you had people from all, not just Berlin coming, but all over, people would travel from all over Europe to come to this club?
I'm sure that some people came for this club. But the people who were performing in our club were usually, I mean, they were already around because we couldn't afford to buy them a ticket or so, you know. So, and Dave Clark was playing there, Christian Vogel, and so it was actually, I mean, it could even happen that somebody famous was playing and there was only 10 people, you know. I mean, it was not, nothing really planned, and sometimes it was completely full, and 50 people would stand outside because the whole place was maybe half of this room, you know. So it was like 60 people would be nice, but 100 would be already crowded, and if it was more, then they had to stand outside, you know.
Now, I mean, you say this this club finished in 1994. Mm-hmm. Is this the time when Electro Music Department started?
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, at first, what was the role of Electro Music Department? Was it to put out your friends' music you liked, or music that you began producing yourself?
No, it was our own music. Because of Electro Club, I met Kotai, and so we started producing together, and it immediately worked. So we thought, okay, why not start a label? I mean, the idea of starting a label was already there before, but we didn't really know what to release on it. I mean, there was like, okay, should we release just the stuff of all these DJs that we were inviting or whatever, you know, but nothing really worked. So then, we just had our own music and we started to release it.
And you also, over the course of the while, you see the fourth release was by Peter Ford, Baby Ford?
No, Triple R.
Triple R. But also, it wasn't just, you had some other people doing stuff for the label as well.
Yeah, but I mean, this was always just friends, you know. Yes. It was something that was coming up just because they were around. So, I mean, Peter Ford did release one record on our label together with Kotai and Bada, and so there was some cooperations, and you know, but normally it was just us.
Yes. Now, and the label is still in existence. It hasn't.
It's still in existence, but it has kind of paused.
When was the last 12-inch released?
The last 12-inch was actually the last thing was this CD. This was released in last year. And
together with Compact?
Yeah, this was no. Yeah, actually, it's distributed by Compact. This one. Before we were with Neuton, and then we changed.
Now, did you do any after any other club nights in this period?
Yeah, we started another club, Panasonic, and this was from 95 to 97. And there we had a concept that we were inviting producers. And they were just presenting themselves in whatever platform they liked. I mean, we would also have producers' nights. Like, I mean, I have a really huge record selection. So we were having, for example, one night of just Leo Anibaldi, which is a famous techno artist from early 90s from Rome. And so it was very intense because of this, because it was not just party music, you know, but just the sound of one person for the whole evening, so it was really thick, you know.
I mean, was there kind of a thing as well where you wanted to start encouraging new producers and just give them a platform to showcase their music, or was it already established producers?
Well, it was just friends, you know, so it was whatever, you know, but I mean, so people were coming up to us saying, okay, you know, I would like to present the stuff that I just did and played out. So, but normally it was just, I mean, the scene in Berlin is still growing, but even at that time it was already quite big, you know, so.
I mean, how's Berlin now? I mean, you know, there seems to be this whole thing, it's very much in vogue of moving to Berlin, and, you know, I can reel off quite a number of people. I'm sure you know the Richie Horton story, and the list goes on. Ah, I'm going to Berlin, the streets are paved with gold, kind of.
Yeah, I mean, still, everybody seems to, if somebody's thinking about moving, seems to move to Berlin. And I think one of the reasons is also because it's, compared to other big cities, still quite cheap, you know. So, I mean, so you can find a way to make your living. You can find a studio that is affordable. And I mean, some other cities just have gone insane, you know, I mean, so.
I mean, you've obviously still stayed there. What do you love most about Berlin?
I like the city. I mean, as architecture-wise, you know, I mean, it has these really wide streets and a lot of parks. I mean, it's, in a way, it's a big city, but still you can just make your living there very easy, you know. And then, of course, I have so many friends by now. I'm living there since 13 years, you know.
Now, I mean, obviously the main thing that you've been involved with for the last 3 years is this company, Handle With Care. Mm-hmm. And like we said earlier on, it is a bit of a grey area, you know. You make your record, everyone's like, okay, I've got my track, I want to get it on record, I can't wait for it to get on the shelf, but there's this whole process in between that, you know, it goes to a plant, what's a pressing plant, you know, what kind of master do I need? It's, you know, it can get really confusing. Just for a bit of history on Handle With Care, who started Handle With Care, and what was the whole ethos behind the company?
Well, it was started 5 years ago by a woman called Silke Radecki, and she used to do manufacturing for Neuton, which is a big
distribution
in Germany, mainly for techno. And so she learned her job there, and then she moved to Berlin, so she started it there. And the idea is to help people do their releases, you know. So, I mean, this was she also was supported by friends, like Perlon is pretty much the first label that was taken care of by Handle With Care because it was a good friend. And so this is how it started.
I mean, what areas does Handle With Care look after? Dun, 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 dun. I mean, what areas of the industry does Handle With Care look after?
What
specific, you know, roles? Is it just manufacturing? Is it publishing as well? What business ends?
Well, it starts from, sometimes people just call us and say, okay, I have my music and I want to put it out, you know. So what we can do is advice, you know, like what needs to be done. And for example, if somebody doesn't have a distributor, which we don't do, we are not distributing, you know, so we can... Hello? Okay, but can you call me in 1 hour? 2 hours. Can you call me in 2 hours? Yeah, okay, ciao.
There's always business to do.
We can give any advice, you know. But what we regularly do is, if somebody already knows what he or she wants to do, is we receive the master and we pass it on to a mastering studio. We work with several studios in England and Germany mainly. And so we choose which one to use together with the person.
I mean, just to give people an idea here, I mean, you say that when it was started 5 years ago, the first label was Perlon that got involved. It's now expanded to what, about 500-600 labels?
Mm-hmm.
Just to give people an idea of who are your clients, who are you looking after here?
Well, me personally, I'm taking care of mainly English-speaking labels, and what we usually take care of is underground labels.
Yes.
So, I mean, I can give you tons of names, but probably you never heard them. And so the bigger ones that we're using, taking care of is, for example, B-Pitch Control, Gigolo, Perlon, Mental Groove, Hefty, Third Ear, then the stuff of Marco Passarani, who actually invited me here.
Yes.
Which is Nature and Pigna. And it's all over, you know.
Musically, all styles as well, or?
Yeah, I mean, can be whatever. I mean, we're taking care of jazz and heavy metal also, but it's mainly, I think it would be 99% electronic music in all kind of aspects. I mean, also more music, do you know it, maybe?
Yes.
So this whole... Bunch and Honest Johns. I mean, it's also even reggae, you know. I mean, we don't really care what kind of music there is on, you know.
So going back to what you're saying, what processes are we going through here from finished in the studio? Maybe it's, you know, one of their friends is a really good engineer and he's mixed it down really well. I mean, does it necessarily go through another mastering process?
Yes.
Tell us about the process from there to there.
Hmm. Okay, so you have your master CDR. It should be either a data CDR or audio. Could be also a DAT, And I mean, could be different formats. So you have your music and you give it to us. And you don't know which mastering studio to use. So I talk to you and you tell me what kind of music it is. You know, like, okay, I want it, like, it's for the dance floor and it should have some power, you know, and it maybe needs some more EQing on the highs, you know. And so I talk to you about the different studios that I would suggest in your case. And let's say I would say, okay, The Exchange is a studio
in
London, yeah. And so I would send it there. And it has to have like a menu and should have all the titles, I mean the exact order and length. And if you want it on 45 or 33, I could also, I mean, you could probably, you would maybe tell me, okay, it's three tracks, you know? So we decide, okay, do you already know which one on A side and B side, you know? And then I would tell you, okay, if it's if one side is longer than 10 minutes, it's definitely done on 33. Mm. And if it's only 7 minutes or so, it can be done on 45. I can tell you about, like, what is preferable, because on...
I mean, what is the limit you can get on, say, 33 without losing sound quality? Because obviously, you know, I hear it's around 11 minutes, but, you know, my old Star Wars album that I got when I was 8 years old is 45 minutes on one side.
Yeah, I mean, you can do up to, yeah, I mean, if you have a regular LP format, you know, it can be like about 30 minutes, but then it's really tight and the volume is pretty low, and I mean, it can still be good quality, but then I would advise to use direct metal mastering, because if you are cutting on lacquer, you can, the good thing about lacquer is the groove. You can cut really deep into the material, you know? The stylus of the cutting machine can go deep. So, and you can use white space, and this makes it sound more voluminous. And if you don't have that, if you cannot use all this space and you have to go with really short distance loops, then you should use direct metal mastering, because the sound would be transferred one to one without. It's complicated. Without losing anything, you know. I mean, so anyway, I would probably talk to you about this, you know. But most of the people that we're dealing with, I mean, they're not using LP format.
They're just cutting 12 inches.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Normally, double A side or EP formats.
Whatever.
Whatever. Now, I mean, when you say these. The mastering house, before it goes to the plant, like you mentioned, The Exchange in London,
mm-hmm.
are these the companies that cut you a master, they master it, then cut a master lacquer,
mm-hmm.
and then the lacquer then goes to the plant?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, they to start the pressing, you need the music, obviously, to be transferred into something that can be used as a stamper, you know? Because, I mean, you have your track on the CDR, and you need it on the vinyl. So the mastering studio would listen to the music, see, okay, how long is the track, and how far can we go up to the center? Because in here, like, the closer you come to the center, the more you would lose resolution.
Uh-huh.
So this is something that the mastering studio is taking care of, you know, like, okay, don't come too close to the center, or if you're, am I still here? Oops. Yes?
Yes. You still there?
So, for example, if you have one track that is with delicate heights and one is more bassy, then probably you would use the one with the highest outside here, because the resolution is better. It's just a physical thing, you know?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Cool.
So this is something that the mastering studio should take care of. And so in the end, you have your music on a lacquer.
What exactly is a lacquer? How does it differ from?
It's bigger. And inside there is a metal, and on top of it there is like an acetate. So it's very delicate, you know. I mean, when we would receive this lacquer from the mastering studio in our office in a box, really big box.
Is a lacquer the same as a dub plate?
No, it's similar, but I mean the dub plate you can use for, let's say, maybe 40 times or so, and then it's just off, you know.
Yes.
So, no, it's different. And this lacquer will be sent to the pressing plant, and then they start the galvanic processing.
I'm sorry, that was the galvanic.
Galvanic?
Galvanic. This word
processing.
Is, can you explain what galvanic processing is?
I hope I can.
Sounds like something out of an asterisk comic.
Yeah, I mean, it's it looks like a chemical laboratory.
Yes.
Actually, it is kind of, you know. So they receive this lacquer and they put it into a machine, and then it will be galvanized with a silver on top, you know. And so, I mean, your lacquer afterwards will be destroyed. Some people, they say, I want my lacquer back, but it doesn't exist anymore, you know, because actually the lacquer would be looking with the grooves just like this. You can even play it, you know. I mean, you could put the needle on and play it. You shouldn't do it because it's really delicate, but you can do it. And then afterwards you have the opposite, like the grooves are not cut inside, but they're coming outside, you know. And of this, you're using, this is like, I think it's called the father, and then you do a mother of it. And so the mother, again, is like this, I mean, something you can play, you know, but it's out of metal. And then, of the mother, you are doing a stamper. So it's again, the grooves are coming out, and this stamper will be put into the machine, you know. And then, so you have one stamper for each side, because of course, I mean, you take this, you make this the positive of it, then again a negative, then again a positive. So you have one on the bottom and one on top. And these machines, they look really old.
Yes.
I mean, it's, you think, yeah, it's, I mean, I think they're still the same machines as in the 40s and 50s, you know. So there is a vinyl granulate that is, it's really hot, you know, coming in into this machine. The labels, this here, the paper labels, they are already there in the machine. They will be on top and on the bottom. Mm-hmm. And then it's pressed. So the vinyl gets inside and will be pressed by the stamper, you know. And then there is some knife that would cut this edge, you know. And then the machine just
runs them all off.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, in today's, you know, modern climate with the advent of CDs, and I mean, a lot of people have been saying it for years that, you know, vinyl will die, blah, 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 blah. And there have been stories of, like, there was a big EMI pressing plant in England that closed down a few years ago. I mean, are these record plants sustaining enough business to maintain a living and keep open?
Mm. Yeah, I mean, there is sometimes, like now, there is another French pressing plant that closed down, and then there is another one in Germany, which was not so much in use anymore, and they just last week they told us that they would stop doing vinyl. So it's definitely not a growing market, you know. But I mean, for us, we as a company, we are growing.
Yes.
And so to us, and yeah, it seems that it definitely doesn't die, you know. I mean, I don't know for how long it will stay like this, but at the moment, it seems like there is. It's still continuously growing a bit.
I mean, at an estimate, how many of these plants are there in the world? More than 100? More than?
No. I think, I mean, for example, in Germany, there is 2 right now, and which we are working with. And then there is 1 in Netherlands. And I think there is 1 in England still, curve pressings. But I worked with them once, and I think they were into weed a lot. So it was taking
into weed a lot.
Yeah, it was taking very, very long. You know, so we don't use it anymore.
Well, I mean, what are the differences between each plant? Like, for example, a friend of mine in New Zealand, I remember a few years back, he got some records pressed, and he went to Czechoslovakia. So you know, there was not much awareness in New Zealand of where you get these records pressed, and he kind of did some research himself, got them pressed in Czechoslovakia. So there were a few other people from New Zealand that would go and get their records pressed at this magical Czechoslovakian plant.
Yeah, I mean, actually, our first record this year has been done in Czechoslovakia, you know. So I've been there, I've been to this pressing plant whenever we did. The first three releases were done there, and we always went there and passed it on to them and have been to the mastering studio there. And so I've seen it. And I think, I mean, there is one in Czechoslovakia, and then there is also one in Romania and one in Poland, I heard.
There is?
And, but we are not working with them. I mean, not because we don't want to, but because the ones that we are working with are just sufficient and it's already working.
I mean, what dictates what plant you'll go with? Is it, I mean, the sound factor sonically, that's already taken care of from the master lacquer. So pressing it at a different plant gonna affect the sound, or is it mainly just for cost reasons and shipping that you use a different
plant? Well, it can affect the sound. Actually, it depends on how they do the vinyl. For example, I mean, my customers mainly are divided into pressing plant in France, MPO, and another one in Germany, Pallas. And Pallas is using more graphite parts in their vinyl, so it's softer. So if you have a very delicate sound, for example, like ambient or something like this, you know, it could be advisable to use the Pallas vinyl. But normally what my customers are coming from is the dance scene, so it's DJs.
Yes.
So it's good that the vinyl is a little bit harder and more resistible, you know, because taking out and in. And so there is a difference of the different vinyl, but mainly it is a calculation problem.
Yes.
And so, for example, for German customers, it's good to use a German pressing plant, because shipping is not as expensive. But I mean, normally when a new customer is coming up to us, we would give them different estimates. Mm-hmm. And by looking at these estimates, you can tell, or we would tell you, which pressing plant to use. Because it also depends on if you're doing, like, let's say for a start, 1,000 copies, and you are planning represses of 300 units within the next couple of months, and then another repress of 300 units. So we can tell that, for example, MPO would be better for you, because their price for small units is better. So in total, it would be more advisable to use this one. Yeah.
I mean, the main advantage with Handle with Care, and you know, I'll use my my friend back home as a case subject. Him going off his own back and contacting this plant, he's only pressing, say, 500. You know, it's going to cost him a lot more per unit, but because within the 500 or 600 labels that Handle With Care does, they treat it as one client, and it doesn't necessarily matter how many you're pressing up of a different track. It's the fact that you're pressing up so many of different tracks that you get a much cheaper rate. Yes.
Yeah. So we are working like a broker. So we have a key account at these pressing plants, and from time to time we are working with new partners, and of course we can tell them, okay, you know, but you say to us you want 120 for this and that, but we get it there for 86 cents, you know, so what should we do, you know? So of course we are dealing in this term, you know.
I mean, what's the preferred choice of format that you guys would like to receive? I mean, DAT, CDR, you know, are MP3s good?
No, MP3 not at all. But yeah, as I said, it's advisable to come up with an audio CDR or data, but then you should ask, like, what's happening? yeah, you should ask like what data you should put in. Actually, there is one studio that we're working with, Duplets and Mastering, and they have a really good homepage. So if you
that's the basic channel guys, one of the guys from the basic channel.
And so if you have interest in that, like what format to use and how to provide it and what can be done, and even like what if you want to have locked grooves to be cut, how they should be done, check their homepage.
Is it difficult to do a locked groove?
No, it's not. I mean, it just needs a certain specification which needs to be followed really carefully. I think it's something like 133 BPM for a 33 RPM groove, and it needs to be, I don't know, 1.8 minutes or seconds, sorry, you know, I mean, something like this. But this is something that you can check on the website of Duplets and Mastering.
And what about another thing is with with Battle Records, correct me if I'm wrong, but Q-Bert and the Thud Rumble guys perfected the skip-proof groove. So, I mean, it's not per se it's skip-proof, but the way the grooves run, they're not a straight circle. They kind of zigzag out so that if the needle jumps, it'll still jump into the same place. You're familiar with that? So the groove is not, a perfect circle. It doesn't go around like that. These grooves on these records, I mean, you probably know better than me, Ahmed.
But what are you talking about?
It's a Thud Rumble, which is a hip hop label. They look after like battle records for hip hop DJs, and they perfected this format where the grooves run, they kind of zigzag the whole way around the record, so that if the needle jumps, it'll like over by one, it'll be at the same sound point as it was when it skipped. I'm probably not describing it very well. Anyway.
I don't know.
Someone also mentioned a glass master. What is a glass master?
That's like a stamper you use for a CD.
Uh-huh.
So with a CD, it's pretty much the same. I mean, the CD, if you want to do a CD, you can give us a CDR that is already mastered, so everything is already in order as it should be on the final CD, and the sound levels are adjusted, and I mean, you definitely would need somebody to do the pre-mastering with you for a CDR, but then we take it, pass it on to the pressing plant, and there they do it glass master in the glass mastering studio. So it's pretty much the same process as for vinyl, but not as many steps, and not as complicated, and it doesn't look as old-fashioned chemical laboratory, but more high tech, you know. But yeah, you have to have a glass master to do the CD.
Now, I mean, obviously, Henna with Care, you know, you don't just look after vinyl, it's also CDs, DVDs, the whole works. Anything a label needs, they go to you. Mm-hmm. I mean, what about, say, for example, is it enough? Rob's still in here. Rob's still here? No. Say, for example, any one of these guys in the studio have got a track and they just want to get some test presses done. You know, they've got a track and they want to get 50 or so done up just so they can hand out to DJs or what have you. Can they get in touch with you guys?
Yeah,
not necessarily being a client per se, but...
Well, they immediately would be a client if they would do it with us. I mean, it doesn't matter. I mean, you can even say, okay, for example, 50 white labels, then... I would tell you, okay, for the mastering, you would have to pay around 340 euro plus galvanic processing and three test pressings, another 170 euro, and then per white label, 1 euro 20 about, you know.
Right.
So, and then there would be shipping of... these 50 white labels, and that would be it, you know. So.
Sorry, can you
repeat the
prices? Yeah. Oh, you can also. I have my card here.
But just for those who didn't hear, then how much was it per unit?
Per unit?
Yeah. So you said 350 for the mastering.
350 for the mastering. I mean, there's like shipping lacquers. To the pressing plant, which is another 20 euro or so, and then 170. If you, for example, if you only want to do three test pressings, shipping of those three test pressings would be for free. Yeah. So, if you don't want to do
anywhere
these,
in the world, they'll ship the test pressings to you for free.
Yes. If you use MPO, you know.
This is the French pressing plant.
Yeah. And this is why I mostly use MPO, because I usually deal with abroad customers, and so it's better for them to receive their test pressings for free. So, it would be 520?
520? 520, that's all you're going to pay. Mastering, three test pressings for free.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, 50 test pressings, you said 1 euro 20 each.
Mm-hmm.
Now, say for example, from those test pressings, you know, I want to run 500. How much is the cost going to come down? And then, say for example, 1,000, how much are we looking per unit?
I'm really bad at prices, I must say. You know, I mean, it depends. If it depends on, like, for example, you have some vision of what the printed label should look like. Then we would provide our specifications, and we hope that you have somebody at your side doing the graphics who knows what he or she is doing. Then you have this. You have to do the films. I mean, we take care of film development. You just send the graphic files to us, and we send it to our developer. Then those films will be sent to the pressing plant. And because they, in France, they have a print shop inside the factory.
But not all these pressing plants offer, like, the artwork service for the sleeves.
No, the sleeves are always printed at a printer.
Uh-huh.
We're usually using different printers. So it also, I mean, it depends on what kind of sleeve you want, you know, and then we would tell you, okay, in this case, we use this printer because for this kind of sleeve, he has better options, you know.
So, I mean, the main thing is how much, say, for example, I'm pressing up 500, how much more am I going to pay going from just that normal sleeve to, say, that? Is it a huge amount? And also maybe even if I want to get some fancy picture that of me when I was a baby and it's very nice and I want to put that on the cover.
Actually, if you only want to do 500 copies, if you...
Exactly.
If
I was a bit prettier than that.
If you are planning to do some money on it, I would advise not to use generic sleeves. I mean, not to use your own sleeves, but to use standard sleeves. This is a standard disco sleeve, it's called, or inner sleeve. I mean, we call it disco sleeve. And there you don't have manual packaging, because the machine where the records are pressed, they fall out and will be put inside automatically, you know. So you save manual packaging, which means, I mean, manual packaging is people standing at a high table and they have this, because either it's a disco sleeve or a paper bag that those records will be put inside automatically. And those people will do it by hand, you know. They will stand there with gloves on and put it inside, you know. Yeah.
This, so the process gets drawn out a little bit.
Yeah, longer. So for this manual packaging, you have to pay per copy 5 cents, you know. And for the paper bag, you also have to pay, I think, 4 cents. So it's only already 9 cents extra. I mean, this disco sleeve, I must check myself. Okay, so it would be 30 cents, just a disco sleeve. I mean, I don't know if it's, it maybe shouldn't go so much into the detail, yeah. Because then I will like sit here with my calculation machine, but, you know? But I mean, of course, if you are using something like this or a standard sleeve, then you would, you wouldn't have all these extra costs of, for this, for example, you need a film, you know, and this is a CMYK, so 4 colors. So you need 4 films. These films will be sent to the printer, and the printer is doing sleeves. You would need at least, if you are doing 500 vinyls, you would need 600 sleeves, because some are getting damaged during transport, and some are getting damaged in the pressing plant. I mean, they're not jumping on them or so, you know, but you just have to have this in mind as well. And then during manual packaging, something can happen, you know. So it's, of course, adding. So if you're only doing 500 copies, it's very expensive to do sleeves of your own.
For new labels, do you generally kind of make people shy away from doing like fancy artwork just because they're a new label and it's better to, you know, keep costs down, or?
Yeah, I mean, of course, I would tell them, you know, because I know that normally somebody's just starting, unless they have a lot of money, normally has to count and calculate really tight, you know. So I would tell them, but some, they just say, okay, you know, I just do it because I love to do it. I don't mind, you know, I don't care. And they do really fancy sleeves, even for 500 copies, you know. So, I mean, I don't stop them, you know.
I mean, do you also, listen to the tracks, say, for example, someone's, you know, they're quite happy with what they've done and they have a feeling it's going to be the next big thing, and they're like, okay, we want you guys to press up 5,000. Mm. Will you sit there and listen to it and just go, you know what?
No.
Just go with 1,000 and maybe repress, or
No. This is something they would have to discuss with their distributor.
I mean, do you have examples where people do just get a bit wayward and press up?
No, not really.
Most labels you're dealing with are in this day and age, are they're just pressing in lots of 1,000 and repressing?
Mm-hmm.
What's the turnaround time from you having the master to actually the finished product? Mm.
Okay, if we receive a master which is done properly, you know, I mean, I'm not talking about a master with a lot of problems, to the day when test pressings are done is, I would say, 2 weeks.
Yeah.
So, and then after you approve the test pressings, and in the meantime, we have received all the graphic artwork according to our specifications, then it would be another 2 weeks to finish the final product.
And once I get my test press back, just arrived in the post from MPO, what am I sitting there to listen for?
first you have to listen to, I mean, you have to check if it's really your own track. I mean, not something, I mean, can happen.
It happens, you know? Yes.
Not very often, but it happened to me personally in Czechoslovakia. But I mean, even in with MPO or wherever, I mean, it can happen. So this is the first thing.
So you get your, then, you think you're getting your techno record back and it's actually a Pavarotti live at
the or some Gabba or, you know.
Some heavy metal.
And so this, and then you just check if there is any crackling noises or so, you know, I mean, anything that could be caused because they were not doing it properly in the galvanic.
Or a bit of dust flew in, that, mm-hmm. that can happen, mm-hmm. yes?
Yeah, sure. And I mean, if you're telling us, okay, there is crackling noises on my test pressings that shouldn't be there, then I would contact the pressing plant, tell them, and they normally immediately do new test pressings just to make sure, you know. If the crackling noise is still there, and if it's even there at the same place, it definitely shows that there was some dirt, uh-huh. you know, or something was done badly with a stamper. So either they would do a new stamper, or sometimes they have to admit that they were just, I mean, it can happen to the best pressing plant, you know, and it, thanks God, doesn't happen very often, but it can happen that they just destroyed the original part, you know, so everything has to be done again.
Yes, but that's at no extra cost to you. The pressing plant takes ownership of that and they will mm-hmm. pay for the
remaker. Yeah, I mean, this is something also that we are taking care of, and we make sure that whoever was responsible would cover the costs. And so, I mean, you may lose time, and this is something that we cannot help, you know.
But, this again is why it's more beneficial to rather than do it yourself, go with a company like you, because you have you know, you've got more grounds to stand on with you're very much more experienced dealing with this. Say, for example, I've just knocked up the best bootleg ever of an old Prince track, and it's just, you know, it's so sample laden, but I just want to press up some cheeky white labels. Can I go to you for it?
Well, what we also take care of is mechanical rights. Mm-hmm. So this is like the first question after you, I mean, when you ask for a pro forma invoice or so, you know. So we would make sure that mechanical rights are cleared.
Okay.
So this
when
means...
When you say mechanical rights, just for everybody, what are mechanical rights exactly?
It's, well, every country, except for the States, I mean, in the States it's a bit different. They do also have associations that are connected to this worldwide organization, but so normally, for example, give an example from Germany because it's easiest for me. Mm-hmm. If you're a German artist and you are planning to produce and to spread your tracks among few labels, it would be advisable that you would register with GEMA, which is the company for mechanical rights in Germany.
And every single country around the world has a different company.
Yes.
Well, in England, it's
MCPS.
MCPS.
And Italy is SEIA.
Yes.
SIAE. Yes. And in France is SACEM, and Suiza in Switzerland, you know. And so this actually works really well. I mean, if you are as an artist, if you want somebody to make sure that you will get your part of every record pressed, you should register with them, you know. And so if you are coming to us as a customer and say, okay, I got my own record, I want 500 copies to be done of a track by myself, I'm a registered artist, then you would have to fill a form. I mean, you can also do it yourself, you can register yourself and then just have the GEMA send a fax to us with a confirmation that this is done. But if you are doing it with us, then you would need to write down like your name, your artist name, your the name under which you are registered with GEMA, the name of the tracks, the length of the tracks, who was the writer, who was a producer, and then the quantity of records to be pressed, and the price, what it will be sold for in the stores in the end.
I mean, how much does it cost to join up with these companies?
It only costs, in Germany, it costs €50 a year.
So. And so do these companies look after, say for example, your track gets played on German radio or English radio, mm-hmm. and you're supposed to get your money back from it. Are they the ones that look after all this?
Yes, they are. I mean, in Germany there is another association, and I'm sure it is existing in other countries too, but I don't know how they are called there, which is like a publisher. It's mm-hmm. GVL, it's called, and they should take care of such things. GEMA is also taking care in a way, but there is like a big bowl, you know, and all the radio stations, they put in whatever they have played out. And normally it's, I don't know, I mean, Prince is having this amount, and Madonna is having this amount, and then there is some underground labels that are like this, yes. you know. So you don't really receive anything of it. Even if they claim that they played your track, your money will be passed on to Prince because he's on top, you know, yes. he's getting the most, yes. you know. So this is something that is not really working, but it's also because many people are not announcing what they play. They have no playlists. If all the clubs, for example,
I mean,
would be...
the clubs are supposed to, you know, if you're getting your music played in a club, you are supposed to be getting money for it. But because it's such a grey area and no one actually writes down what they play...
Yeah, I mean, the clubs, usually they have to pay a fee to those associations.
Even cafes and restaurants.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, I don't know how it's here. I think it's the same. But since they have no playlists, then, I mean, the money goes to those that are played the most, and not to you, you know. But I mean, if all the clubs would go to the DJs and say, okay, what did you play tonight? If they would do it, and if the DJs would fill out these forms, yes. then the situation would be changed, but I don't think it will happen.
Now, these companies, like, so you guys have got direct links with all these, just GEMA, or a lot of the different
No,
just the world.
We are dealing with GEMA, and GEMA is then connecting with all the others.
Or in the world. Mm-hmm. So say, for example, someone's coming to you, they're from a label in Siberia, they want you guys to look after all their mm-hmm. manufacturing mm-hmm. and everything. You will also make sure all their mechanical rights, all that side of mm-hmm. things is covered as well.
Yeah, I mean, depends. If there is a company like this in Siberia, then, I mean, we will contact GEMA, we will pass on the information we have by the artists and the tracks, and GEMA will check if there is somebody connected from Siberia. If not, if they don't have a partner in Siberia, they will see if you are registered anywhere in the world, you know? But if they don't find you as an artist, then they say, okay, there is no licenses to be paid. Okay. So. If you are the label owner releasing your own stuff, you won't need to pay anything, but you also won't get anything.
Yes.
If you are a label owner releasing some stuff of a Siberian artist, you won't need to pay anything, and the artist also won't get anything.
Right.
You know? But if he would be registered, and you are not the artist, you are just the label owner, you would have to pay, and the artist would get it. So this is all the thing about mechanical rights.
What about compilations as well? Licensing to, you know, a major label picks up your track for a compilation. You guys protect the artists, or working with GEMA, and then working with all their companies, you're looking after to make sure that they get their proper royalties and all this sort of thing?
Well, we can give some advice about it, but we're not a publisher, you know, and so actually, I mean, all we make sure is that everything regarding pressing is done the legal way. This is what we are concerned of, you know?
So going back to my original statement, if I come to you with my wickedest new bootleg that's like a Nas beat and some Prince vocal, you guys wouldn't be happy with pressing it on behalf of me?
Well, if you can prove that Prince agreed with that,
yes,
then it's no problem with us, you know. So, I mean, you have, then you would have to clear this in advance, you know. And but if you just say, okay, I won't tell them that it's Prince, I tell them it's me. We don't listen to your music, I just told you, you know. So we pass it on to the pressing plant, and in the pressing plant there is one person that is going through every single release. You know, if you are, I mean, not every, if you are pressing 500 copies, they won't listen to 500 copies, they would just pick one and go through it. I mean, they're not listening to from the beginning to the very end, but they're checking it carefully, mm-hmm. and that they would find out. And then they would inform us and say, hey, you have told us everything is legal, but
right.
it cannot be. I mean, on the label it says Nick whatever, and it's Prince, you know? So everything would be freezed. And I mean, you definitely would have to pay for the whole production, mm-hmm. but you would not get your records.
But I mean, obviously, you know, anyone walking into a record shop, there's millions and millions of bootlegs released all the time. If there's someone at the pressing plant with the eagle eye watching over things, where are these guys pressing their cheeky bootlegs?
I don't know.
Not any of these NPOs or Czechoslovakia.
I don't know. Okay. I mean,
at this stage, are there any questions? Microphone over here. Prego.
Yeah, one of the I'm very much into hip hop music. And I have hundreds of records where some guy somewhere has got an a cappella, like a vocal from one record, an instrumental from another, and just stuck them together and put them out. And I know, like, people have done it all over the world. So in order to be able to do that, because it's quite a creative thing to do in hip hop, and it's a lot of artists don't do it to steal music. They do it to show other people, like, how well these records work together. So in effect, they're promoting the artists. So if I wanted to do that, is that just impossible unless I have a friend
As I said, for us, we don't care as long as nobody is complaining, you know? I mean, and I know that there is records that we did with using samples, and I know that of some of the samples, the original artist is aware. And, I mean, many of them like it, you know? I mean, not because of promotion, but because they like the track, you know? I mean, so if nobody's making any problem, it's okay, you know? And, I mean, all you have to do with us is to either fill in this form. I mean, you don't have to put in, I use the sample of blah, 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 you know? But that you are the creator of this music, and all information about, like, length and etc. You know, this is all that counts for us, in not what is the content. I mean, sometimes we are, I mean, especially lately, we got fascist music, and since we are not listening to it, we just pass it on, you know, and then the mastering studio says, hey, you know, this is no good. Please listen to this. We are not going to do it. So, I mean, it always, for example, this kind of music definitely will be stopped immediately.
When you say fascist music, what are you talking about? Like anti-political sentiment or fascist music?
Yeah, like, I mean, Nazi yes. songs, you know? I mean, they are sometimes trying, you know? So. And I know that some pressing plants that were not so conscious about such things were getting trouble because of this, you know. So, I mean, yeah, as I said, if you are self-confident and you think, okay, you know, I use the sample, but it's okay, just do it, you know. And but if it's not okay, then somebody might come up and say, well, I mean, it's not just using a sample, this is a bootleg of Prince, you know. So then it will be stopped. I mean, of course you can fill in something that is not true, you know, and we won't be able to check it. But if it will be found out at the pressing plant, then...
There's no point.
But I mean, like what you're talking about, it's no problem, you know.
Can I just ask one very quick question? Do you charge a set fee, or do you ask for a percentage of the, what the record makes for your service? You know?
No, I mean, what we are doing is you pay the whole production to us. This is it, you know. There's no extra fee of like, okay, this is going to be a major hit, and so we want to have our profit. So it's just this.
That's great. Thank you.
Any other questions?
How long this sample should be, just to legalize it or not legalize it? For example, it's okay, but I like it. No.
Actually, it's, I mean, first, this is nothing that really matters to us, you know, I mean, because we are not a GEMA or any kind of association. But, I mean, there is a rumor that it says 3 seconds is okay, but as far as I know, it's not, you know. But then, I mean, as I said, it's, if nobody is complaining, you know, if you're using it in your own individual way and nobody is getting a harm of this, then I think it wouldn't be a problem, you know.
That's it. Mo, thank you very much.